Good to see you there. It's Christmas time, and it's such a beautiful time for happiness and imagination, and getting together with family and losing the presents game to your rich cousins.
All right, son, time for you to open your present.
Oh, this one?
Yep.
Cool, you've got me a sandwich bag that's got crochet wool, used an empty beer can, and a broken used condom?
Son, I wore that condom the night you were conceived.
Oh. And you kept it all these years. That's both sentimental and disgusting. Good times. You know, I feel like doing something different. I'm not gonna be playing a game today. I'm gonna go outside and enjoy the winter wonderland that is Christmas time. You know what? I feel like I'm gonna go do that now. Alright, let's go.
Walking in a well. Oh yeah, I live in the southern hemisphere.
Oh, damn, it's way too hot to go outside. What am I gonna do for a video? I mean, I planned to go out and do like a montage video of us having a good time, but I guess that's not gonna happen. And it's Christmas Eve, it's too late to do a Christmas game. I know, what I will do is I will pick a, I'll watch a movie. Like, yeah, that's what I'll do. I'll watch a movie and do what I usually do, but you know what? I want to pick someone that has personified Christmas. Well, fuck.
In life, there are three things that are certain: death, taxes, and a Tim Allen Christmas film. Wait, how many Christmas films has he done? Four! So why is this a meme again?
It's a rite of passage, really. Every great actor has a shitty Christmas movie attached to their name.
Okay, not all Christmas films are shitty, but they're all the same, really. Everyone must save Christmas!
They are so predictable, but in the end, it's something that we'll always come back and watch time and time again. And they're usually a side project for actors and actresses that might not be getting any work at this point in time.
Could you imagine, like, actors and actresses doing these movies in their prime? Like, I don't know, Al Pacino in 1982?
Say hello to my little friend!
But alas, when it comes to Christmas films, the only one that reigns supreme is Tim Allen. I mean, come on, the dude played Santa Claus, and he played it pretty well. In the first film,
Santa Claus was a movie made in 1994 that told the story of Scott Calvin, an executive of a toy company, who on Christmas Eve saw the death of Santa Claus. But after being forced by the love of his son,
aka his son's being a little prick,
Scott Calvin puts on the Santa suit and delivered the toys all across the world and saved Christmas. The end.
Actually, no, that was the first 30 minutes of the movie.
He is then flown to the North Pole, where the elves explain that he is now the new Santa Claus. Over the period of the movie, through slapstick humor and comedy, he becomes more and more like Santa.
I would recommend that you actually go and watch Santa Claus 1, because I will make a few references from that first film into this film. So, yeah, go and do that.
Really seemed like Santa Claus 2 was really a once-off movie. Didn't really leave us on a what if.
But the year 2002 happened, or as I like to call it, the year of shitty Disney sequels.
You had popular movies like Lilo and Stitch, Treasure Planet, and the Country Bears, but you also had straight-to-DVD movies like Return to Neverland, Tarzan and Jane, and Cinderella 2, a full 52 years after the original.
Yep, Disney wasn't cash-grabbing at all. But I guess it worked, because now...
But the year also spawned Santa Claus 2, a movie made 8 years after the original one, and surprisingly kept the same cast with the additionals of new ones.
I was actually shocked when I found out Charlie was the same actor. Well, I guess that's puberty for you. But where do you go from the first film? It seems like everything was wrapped up nicely. Well, I guess we're gonna have to find out, and we're gonna have to unwrap this movie and look for clues. Or claws. Just play them.
We open at the depressing polar ice caps that is the North Pole. That doesn't actually exist. Well, not entirely. There's like a small ice cap there, but it's not enough to hold a sweatshop underneath it.
I'm getting strong readings from underneath the cap rock, sir. Possible oil flow?
Ah, yes, oil. We want that oil. America needs that oil.
Sounds like tiny hammers.
Why is there an underground bunker in the North Pole? Like, who's declaring a... Wait a second.
Possible oil flow!
The oil. It's America. America's the one that's declared war on Santa Claus.
What the bunker is really for is that it's detecting anything from the outside world that may discover that the North Pole is real. For some reason, this place needs to be kept secret.
That's kind of a recurring storyline in both the first film and this film. They keep saying that people lose the spirit of Christmas as they grow up. They do it in sort of a way like they either get bullied or they just grow out of it. It's really hard to explain. But the issue is, when they lose the spirit of Christmas, they make it a big deal because then the people stop believing and the elves will lose their jobs. Wouldn't it just be easier for them to just come out and say, hey, Santa Claus is real, the North Pole is real, Christmas is real? Because then it wouldn't be a problem anymore. But what do I know? I just play video games for a... Oh, shit.
Come to think of it, it's actually proven evidence in the first film. Then again, this is 1994 and they didn't have camera phones back then. They just had shaky camera footage of aliens from their RCA CC413 VHS camcorder.
Take us to ElfCon 3!
Take us to ElfCon 3!
My god, it must be serious if he went straight to ElfCon 3.
These guys aren't stopping. Take us to ElfCon 2!
Let's go to ElfCon 2!
My god. Last time we went to ElfCon 2 was back in 1498. 700 elves didn't come home that night.
Oh, is that the man himself? Oh yes, he's coming to town.
We have a partridge and a pear tree.
All that build up and that's the first line he says. Oh, this is gonna be long.
Yep. You take us to ElfCon 1. Let's rig for silent running. Look alive, everybody.
Oh god, not ElfCon 1. Anything but ElfCon 1.
Expecting that.
But what actually happens is some dumb shit elf starts playing music that can be heard on the plane's radio, causing Santa and his head elf Bernard to find him and stop him.
With force.
We get introduced to Curtis, the second in charge elf that has an unhealthy obsession with the Santa handbook.
It's a handbook, not 50 Shades of Grey.
After a very close call with a reindeer in training, we see it crash, and that's the last time we'll see him for an hour and 20 minutes. Everything seems fine right now. Everyone's just working away, getting ready for Christmas. Also, I would really like that auto-hopping kangaroo with a hat.
I don't care about the counterweight. I want it.
We cut to a high school at night where we're introduced to two teenagers breaking the law by trespassing onto school property.
Goddamn teenagers with your rock and roll and your K-pop tweets.
One of the teenagers is Scott Calvin, the son of Santa Claus, and the girl is...
It actually doesn't matter because that's the only time we ever see her, and that's supposed to be Charlie's love it.
We see what the intentions are as Charlie starts spray painting the walls of the gym? What the fuck?
You do realize who your dad is, right?
Not to mention we get the best three lines of lyrics in a rebellious Christmas song.
I've been a naughty boy. I didn't get a toy. Santa Claus left nothing underneath my tree.
Such poetry. Mwah! Such diversity. Mwah! Such shitty lyrics.
You're fucked.
We cut back to the North Pole where we find Santa feeling a bit different. There is big news that the elves are trying to tell him, and one of them is that his son is on the naughty list.
I'm not gonna lie, this is probably one of the funniest lines out of the movie, and I know it's for the parents that have been dragged to their kids. It's kind of like, here you go, parents, have a bit of a laugh since you're here.
It's Charlie.
Sheen? I thought he straightened out.
Not only that, but he needs to also find a Mrs. Claus before Christmas Eve, otherwise he can no longer be Santa Claus, and the de-santification process has already started. But I didn't need to tell you that because we get a full plot review during the meeting of legendary figures, which includes Cupid, Tooth Fairy, Mother Nature, Father Time, Sandman, and a ginger Easter Bunny?
Of all the legendary figures here, you would think the Easter Bunny has a soul. By the way, the legendary figures cannot fall in love from Cupid's arrow, so don't even try it. They're trying to make this movie go long.
So after Santa's been moping around like a preteen who's just listened to a My Chemical Romance album, Curtis has come up with an idea to clone Santa so that the real Santa can go find a wife and find out why his son's been a little shit, while the toy Santa sorts out everything at the North Pole.
I can see nothing that can go wrong here.
I can see everything that can go wrong here.
Also, I believe that Tim Allen pressured the director to put this in because it's just Tim Allen talking to Tim Allen about how good Tim Allen is.
Ho, ho, ho. Ho, ho, ho.
Not bad.
Not bad yourself. I can't put my finger on it, but there's just something about you that I like. There's just something about you that I like.
All we're missing is the ha, 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 and we would have had peak Tim Allen. And trust me, you do not want peak Tim Allen. 700 elves didn't come home that night.
So Bernard convinces the elves that the toy Santa is the real Santa, even though it sounds more and more like bullshit. Just before Santa leaves, Bernard gives Santa a special watch that has a small bit of magic in it. It explains that if he uses all the magic, he won't be able to get to the North Pole. Yep, I see no way for him to get back. Oh, bye Santa. Enjoy your one-way trip on your flying reindeer. We cut to a high school where we meet Charlie's mother and his stepdad.
I'm actually gonna say that the movie depicts this divorce couple actually pretty well. They always say that the stepfather is an asshole or they're not getting along, but in this film, they actually work together to solve the problems. It's really good, and not a lot of films do that. So, well done, Santa Claus 2. You're doing good.
Here we meet Miss Newman, a stone-cold principal that is more worried about how her school is run than festive cheer.
She's depicted as the first antagonist in this first half of the film, all because she's super strict and has a hard exterior shell that you can't break through.
But they try to push this point across by having the scene where she catches a student skipping class on a skateboard in the school halls.
Why am I like, she's so evil. She's clearly doing her job.
Have you noticed the hallways in this school? There's not a decoration, not a twinkle light, not an expression of the happiness and joy that kids are supposed to be feeling this time of year. I mean, what kind of school are you running?
A public school, Mr. Calvin. The top academically rated public school in the district. That takes a lot of effort and money. And spending any of that money on holiday decorations would take away from the things that truly matter.
To be honest, she has a point.
So it is agreed. Well, only Scott agreed that Charlie learned his lesson and will not do it again. So after a trip to McDonald's, Scott explains the situation to everyone else and they work together to—
Hi, Mom!
Oh, no. Oh, no, you— no. No, you fucking— no. No, you fucking did. No.
Uncle Scott!
How's my little sweet pea? Oh, I haven't seen you in a long time. Well, tell me what's been happening.
Uncle Scott, I learned how to swim underwater and I'm not afraid.
She's adorable.
They knew. They knew people were going to be like, oh, she sucks. I don't want to wait here until her next appearance.
Not to mention, she's actually a key in moving the plot forward. But we're not going to get to that now. Let's see what's happening in the North Pole.
The elves are explaining to the toy Santa that he needs to do everything by the book while he's getting the hang of being, well, a person.
It's a little weird because he has some of the original memories that Santa has, like where his desk is, but he doesn't have the basic human functions like drinking.
But apart from that, he's doing his job well. A little too well.
Ooh, ominous things to come in the future.
Then we get treated to this lovely scene of Scott Calvin's first date.
I'm sorry, did I say lovely? I meant absolutely cringeworthy.
The lovely woman is actually very festive and seems to be a perfect fit. That is until she starts talking about what she wants to do, and that's to become a somewhat country singer that sings Shania Twain's Man, I Feel Like a Woman, but as a Christmas song?
The sprayers are flocking.
Oh,
put up a tree, me. Sports on TV. I want to be free, yeah, to feel the way I feel. Man, I feel like some crazy.
that would be on the homepage of TikTok.
So Scott strikes out and we move on, thank God. Then we get this nice father and son scene where Charlie talks about a girl he likes.
You know, the girl that we'll never see again.
Scott pulls out the snow globe from the first movie to remind us that this is important later, so make sure you write that down because there's a test later. We also get this nice scene with, no, not her. Not her again.
The cuteness strikes again. Take cover.
This is a small scene that gives a sort of reasoning for what happens in the future.
Uncle Scott, are you Santa Claus?
Well, damn, she ain't wasted any time now, isn't she?
Yes, after giving Comet some chocolate, Lucy has become suspicious that her Uncle Scott is Santa Claus, going off the fact that he is the only one ever to own a reindeer.
To be honest, she has a point. He's suddenly arrived and all he has is this reindeer? Like, oh, and I bet some people would be like, oh, well, he could have caught a bus. Like, be for real. Do you really think a reindeer's gonna pay for a ticket? The guy has no pockets.
After a sickeningly cute scene, we cut back to the North Pole. Not much has changed at the North Pole, apart from the toy Santa wanting to see the naughty and nice list. Bernard explains that Santa has already checked it. But alas, the toy Santa is persistent. So Curtis distracts him by getting him to play football. Jesus Christ, dude. Have you ever heard of taking it easy on kids? God, I think Child Protective Services should be knocking on the North Pole's door.
Actually, it's been explained that they're possibly over 300 years old, so technically they're adults.
How'd you get into my house? The door was closed the entire time.
We cut back to quite possibly the most realistic line in a fictional movie.
You've really lost weight. Are you feeling all right?
It wasn't until I got this phone call.
Tim, being bulimic is not okay. You'll lose your taste buds by all the stomach acids hitting your tongue.
Charlie, yet again being a little shit, has spray painted the school again. So Scott bargains with Principal Newman to, instead of suspend him, force him into doing community service. And Charlie is not happy about that.
Everyone?
Do as she says, Charlie.
But I have homework, tests to study for.
You got caught when there was no one around. What makes you think you were gonna get away with this one? And you're getting pissed even though your dad got you out of suspension? Anyway, Principal Newman also forces Scott to join as a parental overseer with her. Next, we cut to the North Pole where the toy Santa is going over the naughty nice list to the elves' dismay. The toy Santa seems to be doing things by the book a little too strictly, and every kid, no matter how small they've been misbehaving, should be receiving coal. This is where the logic of the first part of the movie goes out of the window. The toy Santa explains that there is this one kid in Denmark that wipes a booger.
Booger! Alright, this is getting weird. How do you keep getting into my house?
Christmas magic!
Great. Now my house is haunted.
Anyway, the kid from Denmark wipes a booger on his sister's shirt, explaining they can see what happens, and yet Santa Claus has no idea why Charlie is on the naughty list at the start of the movie.
I know I'm being nitpicky, but I would accept- Wait a minute. I'm harshly criticizing a Disney film made for kids. I'm very lonely.
Anyway, it's beginning to be a bit of a concern, but none of that matters now because we've got community service.
Hey, you in charge of the gangbangers?
I'm sorry, what? What rating is this movie again? Wow, desensitivity started earlier than we thought.
Anyway, this is when Scott and Miss Newman form a somewhat of a connection. This is when Scott starts using his magic by luring a small girl over to him and telling him, oh no.
The first bit of magic that you use is child luring. He sees you when you're sleeping.
It has also come to my attention that it has taken him 27 minutes to actually use it. Being a kid watching this, I reckon they would have forgotten about the watch. But it works to some degree, and now we cut back to Santa making toy soldiers. I'm gonna say this dialogue was unscripted. It seems way too perfectly off the cuff to be scripted. I'll let you guys judge.
It's showtime! You're in the spotlight. Get bigger with me. It's your big chance. I need a little help. I need a little muscle. I need a little nudge. Let's call yourself the Little Nudge. This won't hurt, except for the big electric shock right through your little porcelain body. I'll see you on the other side.
Spooky Wait, it's not Halloween.
We cut back to Scott asking Miss Newman out on a date, but she can't tonight because she's got the school teacher's Christmas party. After agreeing to come along, Scott turns his minivan into a horse-pulled sleigh and proceeds to know a little bit more about her. Miss Newman didn't grow up in a welcoming home, but every time Christmas came around, it was one of the best times of the year. She explains all the good presents she got, ending on a baby doll that she loved very much, but that was the very last present she got, because the next year she got a reality check.
Also, when she's telling this story, Scott tends to interrupt her with some unnecessary Santa facts. Like, remember, he is trying to win her heart.
My dad went through this elaborate charade so that I would believe in Santa Claus. He put a cot by the fireplace so Santa could take a nap.
Yeah, when he has time to take a nap. I mean, you consider the amount of gifts that he would have to deliver, and then why would he nap? He probably needs some coffee.
Yeah, and there was cocoa and cookies and carrots for the reindeer.
That's a good gesture, because the reindeer love carrots, and the thought is really, it's important to them too, you know.
Yeah, and I'd wake up in the morning and the cocoa would be gone and the cookies would be gone and the cot would be must and the carrots nod.
Nod? No, they don't nod carrots, they swallow carrots whole. I mean, if they're good fresh carrots, they'll eat them like that. They love red bell peppers too. Some, you know, the stories, if you read.
We cut to a Christmas party where everything is pumping!
Together now!
Also, the Prime Minister of Australia is here.
Actually, no, the party is shit, and Scott uses a bit more magic to liven up the party. He does this by giving the teachers presents from their childhood, even though Scott Calvin took the job 8 years ago, so how would he have known that? After a montage of all the happy games that they're playing, it ends with Scott giving a baby doll that she talked about earlier?
Not stalkerish at all.
She knew it was Scott, but couldn't figure it out. As they awkwardly share a moment together, it ends with Scott using the last bit of magic to make a mistletoe and seal the night off with a kiss.
Ah, what a wonderful moment, no matter how creepy it actually is. But hey, maybe this movie's starting to turn around. Let's go to the North Pole and let's just see if the toy Santa has changed his ways.
Merry Christmas! Ho, ho, ho!
You've gotta be fucking kidding me. I mean, they didn't go all the way, but for fuck's sake, it is implied. I never thought in my life I would see Dictator Santa Claus.
The only dictator I want to see is this.
So the toy Santa is continuing his rampage by giving all the kids lumps of coal and is forcing the elves to... Oh god, no, no, no.
No one thought that this may be a little weird. No one? Anyone?
Now we have... Oh god, identical soldiers. Oh, they're doing the war.
They find out he's not the real Santa. Let's just move on. Move on.
We cut back to Charlie and friends throwing snowballs at Miss Newman's house, but Charlie's shocked to find that his dad tells his kids to get off Miss Newman's lawn.
Damn teenagers with your wavy hair and your snowball full of lemon juice that tastes nothing like lemons. It only tastes like pee.
Scott finally comes out to Miss Newman explaining that he is Santa Claus. But after all that magic and shit, she can't believe it because we always need a story arc low point and kicks him out. On top of that, we got Charlie being an angsty little prick because he's dating the principal, even though he is fully aware that he needs to find a wife and quickly, but he's all like, oh, whatever, asterisk, rar, asterisk. And then we cut to Charlie shoveling snow with...
No, no, not Lucy. Anyone but Lucy.
Charlie? Is Uncle Scott Santa Claus?
No, of course not. Why would you think that?
I'm pretty sure she's cracked the code, Charlie, so I wouldn't even bother. But anyway, Lucy tells Charlie in a six-year-old way to stop being a little prick and walks away. So we cut back to the concentration camp that is the North Pole for a shit joke, and then we cut back to Scott Carling playing Go Fish.
Got any twos?
Go Fish.
That delayed response makes me believe that guy's got some twos.
Anyway, Curtis somehow escapes the North Pole and jetpacks so gracefully to Scott's location. He meets Lucy and basically reassures that Uncle Scott is Santa Claus, but Curtis defuses the situation by scaring the poor little girl for life.
How come you have pointy ears?
It's because I never ate my green vegetables. Do you eat your green vegetables?
Uncle Scott!
Curtis finally meets Scott and explains that North Pole has gone to shit and needs to come back. But Scott explains that he has no magic to get back.
I thought you had come.
Yeah, we...
Yes!
Oh my god, they're not stupid after all.
But it turns out Comet has eaten way too many chocolates and is now too fat to move.
Sure, fuck it. This train wreck's derailing anyway.
Ugh. After thinking it over, they come up with an idea to get the Tooth Fairy to help them by pulling one of Scott's teeth out. After a bit of slapstick comedy, Lucy comes in and moves the story forward by losing a tooth.
I'm not kidding when I said she is the key to moving the plot forward.
They capture the Tooth Fairy, and after a bit of convincing, the Tooth Fairy figures out that Scott is Santa and flies them back to the North Pole. We cut to Miss Newman cleaning her car, and Charlie walks up and discusses why he's being an angsty little shit. After a bit of reluctancy by Miss Newman, Charlie shows the snow globe that he got, and through the power of childhood belief, she believes that Scott is Santa Claus, even though there is nothing in that snow globe to prove that he actually is.
But there's 25 minutes left, so I'm not questioning it.
Scott, Curtis, and the Tooth Fairy arrive at the North Pole, and after a few words of testosterone and manly reassurance, the Tooth Fairy flies away. They think they're being sneaky, but immediately get caught. After locking all the elves away, the toy Santa has a few words with Scott about his plan and walks away.
Oh yeah, by the way, it's Christmas Eve. You don't figure this out until Toy Santa tells you.
After a bit of moping around from Curtis and Scott about how they're shitty people, Charlie rappels down?
Huh?
What happens is Charlie forced himself to lose a tooth so the Tooth Fairy can fly him and Miss Newman to the North Pole.
Poor Tooth Fairy, man. I mean, the dude's flown to the North Pole twice.
And if anybody cares, I'm exhausted.
I care.
After putting on his goggles twice, the Tooth Fairy flies away. They free the elves and they go and stop Santa! Yeah. What actually happens is they call on Chet, the reindeer in training that hasn't appeared since the first 6 minutes in this movie, and it is actually now, what is it? 1 hour and 25 minutes into the movie. Fuck's sake.
We're nearly there, come on!
They chase the toy Santa to stop him from escaping while the elves fight the toy soldiers. After climbing onto the sleigh and a Toy Story reference,
you are a sad, strange little man!
Scott is successful. They shriek the toy Santa and Scott puts on the suit, but the only issue is that he needs to get married right now.
This is all happening so fast.
Well, there's no pressure.
Good.
I mean, if I don't get married, I just won't deliver the gifts. Children everywhere will stop believing. The elves will lose their jobs. The North Pole will disappear and Christmas will be gone.
No pressure.
She agrees and they get married. And just in an instant, married life has taken a hold of Scott Calvin and becomes Santa Claus and is off to go save Christmas. To finish the movie, Charlie wakes up Lucy and brings her downstairs to see something magical.
What gave it away, Lucy? What gave it away?
They tell Lucy that she can't tell anyone that Scott is Santa Claus and says that it's okay to keep secrets.
Even though it led to Charlie's delinquency and will most likely put him in jail for graffiti and destroying public property. But isn't that the spirit of Christmas? Anyway, guys, I believe that this is the end of our show. So Merry... What was that?
Damn reverse burglars are at it again.
Dear Boomer, you have been a naughty boy, but you're not gonna get coal. To kick off your 2020, I have found the worst game. Good luck, Boomer, you smelly piece of shit.
Do you mind?
Thank you for watching, guys. Merry Christmas to all, and I hope you guys have enjoyed this video, but I couldn't have done this alone. A big thank you to the ghost of my Christmas video, Sardonic Pickle.
Hello.
So check him out, guys. I'll leave a link either here or here.
Yeah.
There.
Do it there.
Yeah. Thanks, Dave.
No worries.
What did you get for Christmas?
A friend.
Friendship.
Friendship's the best present and
yes,
gift.
Yes, it is. Now, Dave, in the spirit of Christmas, in the last 20 seconds of this video, you can also check out these videos right here, as well as you've got 20 seconds to get out of my house, or I will... I don't know how long the 20 seconds has been. But you better fucking hurry.
I'm getting out.
Now!
No, okay.
Now!
Okay.
Now!